Okay.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me well in the last round? Okay. I will try to present you an overview of the central role of transference analysis in psychodynamic psychotherapies. It feels a little kind of uncomfortable to talk about the general strategy of treatment within a general treatment approach after what you've heard in so direct and human and warm and convincing terms about how to deal with patients. So there's a risk that this may be perceived as rather abstract and general. So I want to give you that note of warning. Hopefully, in the course of what I'm presenting, you'll see that all of this refers to very direct, immediate, and emotional issues. Roughly, one can divide treatment approaches to borderline personality disorder into two groups, cognitive behavior therapists and psychodynamic psychotherapists. You have heard mostly about cognitive behavior therapies, with exception of what you have heard about mentalization-based therapy, which is psychodynamic psychotherapy, in which what I'm going to call transference is examined to some extent. In general, all psychodynamic psychotherapies are really based ultimately on psychoanalytic theory, but psychoanalytic theory is a very broad spectrum of theoretical approaches that has changed radically over the years and is represented most accurately and sophisticatedly in its present form in psychoanalytic object relations theory, and I'll say a few words to explain what this is all about. What is transference analysis? First of all, what is transference? Briefest definition, transference is the unconscious repetition in the here and now of a dominant pathogenic conflict of the past. In other words, transference is the expression of behaviors in a present interpersonal situation that is directly or indirectly linked to past pathogenic influences that have determined the present pathology of the patient. In the case of borderline patients, their abnormal experiences, behaviors, feelings, interactions relate to early experiences that have left traces of an abnormal interaction with the environment, deep traces that have determined the internal models of behavior and that get reactivated in present-day experiences. The predisposition of the individual to behave in certain ways, mostly determined by affect dispositions, may be normal or abnormal. And the normal and the environment in which an individual comes into the world and develops in the first few years of life may also be normal or abnormal. As you have already heard, there are genetic and constitutional reasons for which an excessive disposition to negative affect activation predominates, which prepares the individual to react in an excessive, negative, aggressive way to frustrating, painful experiences in the environment. And from the beginning of life, the environment in form of the relationship between infant and mother and then infant and other members of the family may in turn prepare or confront the baby and the small child with a lack of adequate responses to his affect activation, leading to the difficulty in the normal function of attachment, which consists in an appropriate experience of the baby's experience, reflecting it and modifying it in the interaction so the baby can internalize in the interaction a modification of his own affect in a moderate, cognitively integrated way. In this way, attachment fosters normalization of affect under intense extreme circumstances. When that goes wrong because of the neurobiological predisposition of the baby or the difficulty that comes from the maternal or other members of the family, then negative affect, instead of being modulated and reduced, becomes excessive and dominates the affective memory of the experience in which early development has occurred. Early experiences with others, in short, represent an integration of both neurobiological predisposition and environmental influences in the form of the reaction, family reaction, then psychosocial response to the baby's and the child's affect activation. In all cases where, for reasons of excessive activation of negative affect on one side or the other, bad experiences evolve, traumatic, frustrating, frightening, rage-producing experiences, these are internalized as affective memory of interactions. And these affective memories of interactions that that then constitute internal models of later reproduction of such interactions have certain basic components, a components of self, a representation of self, and a representation of the person with whom one interacts, representation of object, as it's called in object relations theory. So that we have thousands of internalized affective memories of interactions, some of them, many of them, of a very positive, happy, joyful, gratifying kind under normal circumstances of gratification of babies and children's needs and good interaction within the family, and others that are bad, terrible, under the effect of traumatic experiences, excessive activation of negative affect, and of course when pathology dominates, there is a strong segment of such negative internalized interactions in contrast to the limited availability of positive ones. Now, what evolves throughout time is a conflict between the wish for good, gratifying experiences on the one hand, and the traumatizing memory of bad experiences. And under conditions of uncertainty, if there have been many memories of bad experiences, the present is reinterpreted, misinterpreted in terms of the internalized models from the past. And behaviors that correspond to bad experiences of the past are activated now when they are not corresponding to the present reality and perpetuate bad experiences, a reinforcement through misunderstandings and the reaction of the environment to excessive activation of negative behaviors in the person who has that bad internalized environment, and lead to pathology of interactions, fixation of patterns of habitual behavior that are tinged by these negative experiences. We call character the dynamic integration of all behavior patterns, and when negative experiences have been strongly predominant, they show as predominantly conflictual aspects of present personality and personality disorder. So under conditions when traumatic negative experiences have prevailed in the past, these are maintained as dyadic structures, as affective memory between self and others under the dominance of such bad experiences, with the tendencies to reproduce them because they are internal model of habitual behavior that's activated under conditions of negative circumstances or uncertainty. So from this viewpoint, all unresolved serious conflicts from the past, sufficiently serious to distort one's relationship and interaction with significant others, tend to get activated again in the future and determine the clinical characteristics of personality disorder. So that, going back to the definition, the unconscious repetition in the here and now of pathogenic experiences of the past becomes the dominant way in which personality disorders are reflected in present-day behaviors. It's important to keep in mind that one doesn't repeat in the here and now real experiences in the past, but a combination of such experiences, fantastic distortions of them under the impact of the immaturity of early mental functioning, and as product of protective fantasies one develops as a protection against the activation of such bad experiences. Under, in a certain way, we all express the results of our past experiences. Our personality is determined by the early patterns of interaction that we have internalized, metabolized, changed, and harmonically integrated in a character with which we confront the world. So we all transfer to some extent, but when there are severe problems in the past, the past is so strong that it tends to distort the present significantly. While if the past has been relatively normal, then we are all capable, under the influence of the realistic relations with everybody else, to normalize our behavior and behave eventually in a socially appropriate way that is both gratifying our needs and experiences and the demands of the environment. So transferences are universal. They tend to be particularly intense when they have serious pathology. They tend to be neutralized under the effect of social interaction and activated when there is uncertainty in social interaction and a predisposition to distortion of the reality under the impact of such a past. So what is done in psychodynamic treatments is a major effort to influence, modify, resolve the pathological conflicts from the past as they get activated in the present, and tolerate the activation of these conflicts in the present in order to understand them, transform them, resolve them, and help the personality of the individual to become normalized. How do we do that? First of all, by setting up a, quote, normal interaction in the treatment situation. In the psychodynamic psychotherapy, we invite the patient to sit face to face and tell the patient that his task is to freely say whatever comes to mind without being concerned whether it's good or bad, interesting, boring, aggressive, friendly. The freedom of full expression in the hours is stressed as the basic method. This is called free association. And we tell the patient that we will be listening attentively, and whenever we have a chance to add to the understanding of the patient, we'll say so. The role of the patient is to communicate what goes on in the patient to the limits of self-awareness. Our effort will be to extend the limits of self-awareness, and that's the essential method of the treatment, that if you think of it, assumes that the patient is able to speak openly about himself, herself to be sufficiently trusting to do that, and have sufficient confidence in the therapist as a benign person who is well-intentioned, who has some knowledge without being omniscient, who has capacity to help and experience without being omnipotent. So it is a basically trusting, dependent relationship that we are setting up as the, quote, norm. And the therapist acts attentively, responding to what the patient is saying, but with an effort to understand and explain, rather than reacting effectively in the way in which the patient may be trying to make him react one way or another. The therapist doesn't enter into the internal problems of the patient that the patient is activating. We call that neutrality. Neutrality doesn't mean indifference or being like a robot, but a concerned objectivity. So technical neutrality and free association are the methods by which then we create a situation that basically has an element of uncertainty to the patient and therefore activates the transference disposition that in ordinary social life are much less available and in the case of pathology become extremely intense. And from the beginning of the treatment, patients change this relationship to intensely positive and negative kind of relation that reflect the unconscious past in the treatment. And that we call the activation of transference and the interpretation of the meaning of what is going on now in terms of that unconscious past constitute what we call interpretation and transference analysis. And the basic hypothesis of the treatment is then that there will be an activation of such regressive patterns, we'll examine them, and as such permit the present mature part of the individual to become a better understanding, to cognitively integrate those early traumatizing emotional experiences, reduce their influence, permit to integrate the past in new ways and normalize his emotional experience and behavior. So activation, examination, and conflict resolution constitutes the process by which we resolve the unconscious past. Now, this, of course, will remind you immediately of the process of mentalization, and psychodynamic psychotherapies indeed are strongly based about mentalization, defined as an effort to help the patient realize the nature of the affect activated in him, to have a realistic assessment of what he's feeling, its intention, its meaning, and a realistic assessment of what the therapist is presenting to him, is experiencing and communicating. So mentalization signifies the capacity to reflect on the affective conditions that are being activated, and the interpretation of the emotional experiences leads that in the here and now leads to mentalization as a realistic assessment and cognitive framing of intense affective experiences of a positive and negative kind. So here there is a level of analysis that differentiates the psychoanalytic psychotherapies such as transference focused psychotherapy from mentalization based therapy, in the sense that mentalization based therapy attempts to clarify all the present experiences in the here and now and normalize the understanding of the immediate interaction. Transference-focused psychotherapy attempts to go to a deeper level of unconscious happening that are typical of the first few years of life. And here I bring a complication into what I've said so far. I talked about the fact that under positive or negative affects, intense experience of a positive and negative kind are activated. Originally, early positive and negative affect systems occur separately from each other. They occur separately because their origins in the limbic system and their cognitive framing in the prefrontal cortex keeps them completely separate. And it is only throughout time that at the cortical level there's a possibility of integration of positive and negative experiences that permits the infant and the child to bring together extremely opposite affective experiences with significant others, and in the process integrate the view of himself as good and bad, and the view of significant others as having good and bad aspects, tolerate the ambiguity and complexity of self and of others, and acquire a more realistic and complex view of experience. We've been developed over the year an integrated concept of self and an integrated concept of the representation of significant others that constitute our internal world of object relations. And when we treat patients who have conflicts but not of the severe level of personality disorders that includes borderline personality disorder in a strict sense, we always deal in the treatment with an integrated self that may be regressive and different views of the therapist that changes under different transference situation, but always the individual remains with the same self-experience. In the case of borderline personality disorder and all other severe personality disorders, that normalization has not been achieved. The strong predominance of the negative segment of experience has been such that psychological mechanisms perpetuate the original neurobiological dissociation between positive and negative affect systems. And there are psychological mechanisms that persist in a strict separation between ideal and terribly bad persecutory states of mind. And the contradiction between these extremes distort experiences that are reinterpreted as being extremely good or extremely bad. And there's an ongoing search for idealized experiences to avoid the emergence of terribly frustrating one. And that brings about the contradiction in behavior, in the extreme changes from positive to negative, negative to positive moods in severe personality disorder, and shows in the treatment situation as alternation between radically opposite mental states. And in psychodynamic psychotherapy, in transference-focused psychotherapy, we attempt not only to clarify each mental state so that the patient has a more realistic view of his own intention, the therapist's intention and interaction, but we try to bring together the extremes of opposite experiences at different points of time to help the patient understand the processes of radical dissociation that have been dominant in his mind. And so mentalization now goes to a second, more complex level, not only the clarification of the immediate relation, but the integration between extremely opposite internal emotional experiences that reflect those primitive, idealized, and persecutory distortions of interactions that are at the origin of the pathological developments in personality disorders, so that there is one level of mentalization in which a person recognizes what he or she is feeling and what the other is feeling. And there is a deeper level of mentalization in which we can compare what we are feeling with an integrated view, because we don't have those basic dissociations or splits between idealized and persecutory segments in our mind, and we can recognize not only the immediate behavior of other people, but how it fits into their general personality throughout time, because we have an integrated view of them that's not dissociated between idealized and persecutory experiences that we've had with them. So mentalization at an immediate level is like ordinary introspection or insight. Mentalization at the deeper level is the integration of mutually dissociated emotional states that is attempted in transference-focused psychotherapy, which attempts to go to those deeper levels by a particular technique to which I will come back. But practically, that means then that you can clarify an immediate situation, normalize it, or you can do that in a way which at the same time links it with others' opposite situations, deepens and generalizes one's understanding of self and others. So in borderline patients, what we do is to try to facilitate the activation of dissociative processes. We target them to mentalize these and obtain an integration of the patient's self and internalized world of object. The fact that in the treatment, this process of analyzing the present interaction, the transference, as a reflection of the past, has a positive therapeutic effect, has empirical evidence. First, in the Menninger project, in which we were able to demonstrate that in contrast to supportive psychotherapy, which does not analyze transference, and psychoanalysis, which does it, but without any limiting and structuring elements of the treatment, which limits the possibility of psychoanalysis for very seriously ill patients, psychotherapy in which transference analysis is carried out within carefully controlled circumstances that limit the possibility of the patient carrying out self-destructive behaviors as a consequence of activation of primitive dispositions that are not being carefully monitored and controlled and limited. So the combination of transference analysis and external structuring of the treatment brought about profound increase in mentalization in contrast to supportive psychotherapy and in contrast to straight psychoanalysis. Second level of research, Luborsky's CCRT, the treatment of analyzing core conflict relationship themes in the interaction between patient and therapist was an effective way, a highly effective form of psychotherapy. Sandel and others in Sweden demonstrated that comparing psychoanalysis and psychoanalytic psychotherapy, psychoanalysis in which psychoanalytic psychotherapy in which transference was only interpreted in a limited way, in contrast to transference-focused psychotherapy and psychoanalysis, in which transference was analyzed systematically. Transference had, psychoanalysis had greater and more sustained long-term improvement than that kind of psychotherapy. And our own studies at Cornell comparing DBT, supportive psychotherapy based on psychoanalytic principles, and transference-focused psychotherapy demonstrated that transference-focused psychotherapy improved reflective function, that is to say, the increase in mentalization significantly more than both supportive and supportive psychotherapy and DBT. So we have empirical evidence, and I would like now to go briefly to some conceptual issues. What is it really that is repeated in the transference? Is it the neurocognitive predisposition of the patient? There's evidence for rejection sensitivity based upon abnormal function of certain brain structures and neurotransmitters? Is it a consequence of insecure attachment, of traumatic experiences? There's evidence for the importance of early sexual abuse, physical abuse, chronic witnessing of physical and sexual abuse. Is it a consequence of the unconscious conflicts from early development between love and loving and hateful experiences that psychoanalysis has focused upon, or is it all of the above? I think there is good evidence that all these elements influence the development of the internalization of pathological early interactions, and that in different patients, different aspects of these etiological factors predominate, but they get all integrated by the internal combination, integration, and addition of negative experiences that become consolidated in a certain unconscious vision of reality that's activated in all interpersonal interactions. Different technical approaches to deal with transference activation. In general, the cognitive behavioral approaches don't address the transference, although that may be true particularly for pure cognitive therapy in Beck's therapy, in which cognitive schema are clarified, internal cognitive schema, but not the in the relationship between patient and therapist. In DBT, there is an exploration of patients' presentive abnormal interaction in terms of validation and skill training, as you have seen, but the development of such conflicts in the relation between patient and therapist is not directly explored. In interpersonal therapy, there is intense exploration of the patient's difficulty with other people, and to some extent, if those major problems are activated in the treatment itself, that is included as a secondary element of IPT, but not a major a major object. In supportive psychotherapy, based on psychoanalytic principles, there is an exploration of the distortions in the present interaction, but only in terms of a emotional and cognitive analysis of the inappropriate, distorted present behavior in the interaction. The patient is taught how to normalize his interaction with the therapist, and that learning is transferred to the patient's experiences outside the treatment situation. So in supportive psychotherapy, transference is examined in the interaction in terms of its inappropriate nature, normalized in terms of more appropriate interaction with the therapist, and used to help the patient improve his relationship with significant others. It is really a cognitive behavioral therapy based on psychoanalytic principles, one might say. In mentalization-based therapy, the therapeutic situation is normalized by helping the patient understanding realistically his own experiences and intention, the misperception of the own intentions and experiences, as well as those of the therapist, and the patient learns to realistically assess intention, behavior, and the interaction with the therapist. In psychoanalysis, there are three major psychoanalytic currents, and they are of interest from the viewpoint that of transference examination, because in relational psychoanalysis, the assumption is that the distortion in the present is a repetition of traumatizations that the patient has experienced in the past, and the therapist attempts to reduce the traumatic experience that the patient has of the present interaction in terms of his past experiences. The therapist communicates directly to the patient his own experiences and reaction, reduces in this way, realistically, by an empathic relationship with the patient, the negative experience of the present, and permits to gradually improve the internal experience of resolve the remnants of past internalized traumatization. In ego-psychological psychoanalysis, different from relational one, the therapist does not attempt to resolve the present traumatizing distortion of the relationship, but maintains a strict attitude of technical neutrality to permit the patient to go to the deepest levels of the distortions of the past and help the patient come to terms by emotional and cognitive understanding of what it was that the most terrible aspects of the patient's past, internal past, and helping the patient to re-examine and resolve it in the light of the realistic and collaborative exploration of that past with the analyst. In Kleinian analysis, the same way of dealing with the transferences in ego-psychological analysis is carried out, but with the addition that while serious regressions occur in the treatment situation, the therapist is also very attentive to the entire experience of the patient outside the treatment situation and relates the present experiences in the patient's life outside the treatment situation to what is activated at the deep level of transference development in the treatment situation. That is called total transference analysis. It adds a powerful dimension to the analysis of the distortions that occur in the relationship with the analyst. In all these psychoanalytic treatment, the basic techniques are then interpretation of the transference from a position of technical neutrality and the utilization of the therapist's emotional reaction, not to act on them, but to understand better the deeper meanings and implications of the patient's affective reaction to the therapist. Countertransference is like an intrapsychic instrument of the therapist to diagnose in depth the relationship that is being activated. And finally, in transference-focused psychotherapy, the treatment that we have developed at Cornell, we have been using fully, and as I mentioned before, an object relations theory approach. In other words, the analysis of the present activation of behaviors from the past in terms of their self representation and object representation activated in the treatment situation. The patient enacts his self-experience from the past while projecting onto the therapist the experience of the significant others with whom the conflict occurred. There are moments in which the patient does that, activating self and projecting object, and there are other moments in which a reversal occurs and the patient enacts the experience of the other person in the past while attributing his self experience to the therapist, and in his behavior activates a relationship so that he manages to create that past in a live, intense, affective relation with the therapist. And the therapist acting from a position of technical neutrality helps the patient realize which is his self-representation and which is the object representation and what was the total relationship that the patient has internalized, and then to relate that relationship of an extremely positive or extremely negative quality with its corresponding opposite from which it is dissociated. So the treatment implies an expanded view of interpretation, in that interpretation includes the linking of opposite emotional relationship and resolution of their defensive function, the deepening of mentalization, an expansion of the total transference analysis that I mentioned to you before, in that the therapist attempts from a common sense perspective to look at the total life situation of the patient and to what extent the patient, without being aware of it, may have limited, restricted his life opportunities under the effect of the profound conflicts that have colored his own experience of life and permit broadening of purpose and goals of the treatment. Technical neutrality is interrupted if limits have to be put to the patient, to the behavior of the patient. We make condition of the treatment that the severe activation of a negative affect situation be controlled in ways that avoids dangers to the patient, to the treatment, or to others. And countertransference is used consistently to maintain track of the rapid changes of emotional experiences typical of these patients. I was going to give you illustrations of significant different transferences and how they are resolved, but I can see that I only have 15 minutes before that horrible noise starts. So I will give you a clinical example of the treatment of the patient to illustrate this. This is a young woman, about 22 years old, very interested in music, started college, dropped out, severe borderline personality disorders, multiple suicidal attempts every 4 to 6 weeks, overdoses of medication, street drugs. She was in coma for days, and it is remarkable that she didn't develop an organic brain syndrome because of the frequent repeated comatose states from which she had been rescued. She had been in therapy with 3 therapists, different kinds of therapists. The therapists interrupted the treatments because they felt they couldn't control the life of this patient. Multiple drug abuse, sexual promiscuity, some antisocial behavior in terms of getting pregnant, having a man who had money pay for the pregnancy, saying that it was his child when it was really somebody else's pregnancy, violent affect storms in which she would destroy objects, attack people verbally, not physically. I think you get a picture of the patient. In the treatment, the treatment started, instead of coming to session one, she had a severe suicidal attempt. And so by the time she came out of the hospital, she had already defied the conditions that I made. If she felt suicidal, she had to go to an emergency room, and they would decide whether she had to be hospitalized or not. If she could control it, she should come to the session and we would discuss it. And I told her that if she could maintain that structure, I could treat her. If she broke that understanding and made a suicidal attempt, I would stop the treatment and refer her to another treatment. And it was in response to that that the patient made a suicidal attempt instead of coming to the first session. We always give the patient a second chance. And so when the patient then called, I saw her, I told her, this is your second chance. But this means that this happens once again, it's the end of the treatment. Now, one aspect of the technique is whenever we put a limit, we immediately interpret the implication of that limit setting for the emotional relation with the therapist, because it is the therapist acts like a sadistic authority. You have to do what I want. And the patient feels like a victim who has to rebel. This is already the transference. It's not the patient who trusts the therapist and talks about the past and the therapist is friendly and nice. It's a violent situation. So from session one, I pointed out to her that she perceived me as a horrible enemy who was putting restriction on her when, rather than leaving her the freedom to kill herself whenever she wanted to. And that she felt herself to be my victim and resented it bitterly. And while on the one hand she wanted to be helped with treatment, on the other hand, I could see the temptation to commit suicide again to show me who was in control. The patient then enraged, remained silent for almost 10 sessions, and I pointed out to her that now her suicidal attempts have been transformed into these attacks through silence on the treatment. One day the patient told me that she was not going to come to the next session. I asked her why not. She said, that's my business. I told her the patient was part of our research, and we had made a contract what sessions where she could come and what not. And I said that there was absolutely no reason not to come to the session. that I felt this was a problem regarding our commitment to regularity. She felt this was an unethical attitude on my part, got enraged. It became a major issue whether this would count as a session in which she had not fulfilled her commitment or not. She said she was going to accuse me for ethical misconduct to the New York State Medical Society. And so it gradually, her accusing me of being dishonest became stronger and stronger. And I said, well, it's obvious that she's struggling with a dishonest authority who pretends being ethical and being correct when it's really just a dishonest effort to control her, manipulate her. And that was the same as aunt of hers, who was the main person in her past, had a kind of a function as mother, given the family situations that I haven't explained, and that aunt had been a terribly cruel, sadistic person that beat the patient up green and blue and during the entire childhood. The patient had not dared to go to gym classes because she was ashamed of the way she looked. This is how that treatment started. And then there were moments in which the patient would make fun of me in the entire session. She would sit on my desk and push her legs into my face. I had to sit back. And she came to one session with a scissor and cut all the plants in my office. She would wait at night on the patio of the hospital while I was going to my car to yell and insult me. You are going home, utter you shithead! So that the entire hospital could hear how I was being characterized. And at other moments, this patient, after treating me like this one session at the end, she said, I have to tell you something very serious. I said, it's the end of the session. She said, no, this is really important, Dr. Kernberg. You must listen. I said, it's the end of the session. Goodbye. And the patient left crying and looking desperate. And the secretaries who were sitting there looked at me. What has this man done to this poor patient? So there were sessions in which she felt that I was a brutal parent and she was victim. And others, when she was a brutal parent and I was a victim. And then there were other moments where she felt good about me. I was a wonderful therapist. She loved me. She said, I wish we were kangaroos. You would be a kangaroo mother and I would be a kangaroo baby. I would sitting in your pouch and look at the world and everything would be perfect. So there were intense positive experiences. At one point, my house burned down in Scarsdale. And it was in the papers, and the patient came to the first session after that, huge bunch of flowers, white flowers, this is for you. She said, what can I do to help you? This is the most terrible thing. Patient was desperate. She was like an ideal mother taking care of a severely traumatized child. So I'm summarizing those extremes, but if you set up such a technical neutral situation in which she was free to do whatever she wanted to in the session, as long as, when she cut my plans, I stopped the session. But she knew, I stopped the session, but she could come to the sessions. So this patient was also a telephone caller. She would call me day or night, for nothing, and the therapist who had interrupted the therapy before, it was not only because of the suicidal attempts, but because they couldn't tolerate those endless telephone calls. So I told the patient, look, if you have an emergency, you can call me anytime, day or night. If it is something that's not an emergency, I tell you it's not an emergency. And if you call me for something that's not an emergency, I won't take phone calls for a week. You call me again for something that's not an emergency, I won't take a phone call for a month. You call me again for something not an emergency, I won't take a phone call for a year. And you do it again, I won't take a phone call for your entire treatment. And one day you will be on the street bleeding to death, and I will read about it 3 days later in the paper. So you notice that this is not technical neutrality. In other words, we put strict limits, but always immediately interpreting the emotional meaning of that in terms of the patient's actualization of internal conflicts. So this is what permits us to go into the deepest depth and not having to soothe or tranquilize the patient to avoid the intensity of the extreme experiences. And so gradually then, and that's the essential aspect, we integrate those contradictory experiences. In example of this case, one day the patient came in, advanced stage of the treatment, and she said, you know, if you, Dr. Kernberg, had a red telephone, and I had a red telephone like the Secretary General of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union and the President of the United States, and I knew that every time when I called on that red telephone, you would answer and would interrupt whatever you're doing, whether you're sleeping, whether you're playing football, whether you're teaching, whether you're having sex, whatever you do, it would stop to talk with me, I would be perfectly all right. And I told her that is a perfectly normal experience and demands of a three-month-old baby. She said, I'm not a three-month-old baby. I said, that's your problem. That only if I am the perfect mother and you have the perfect relation with a perfect mother, being a three-month-old baby, can you avoid that I become your aunt, that woman who beat you to pulp. And that experience of me as a horrible, sadistic enemy who is manipulating, controlling you. And so only a perfect relation can avoid that terror. That's an integrating interpretation. The patient started, I'll give you one example of hundreds in different sessions. So the patient started to realize that she was looking for dependent, ideal relation as the only way to avoid those other experiences to creeping up in her mind. And this was a very successful treatment. The patient went back to studies. The patient ended up becoming, going back to music school, becoming an expert musician, and having a satisfactory professional development, being able to marry, having children, my follow-ups of 5 and 10 years. So our treatment is not geared to improve the symptoms or immediate behavior, but to change the personality. It's an intense, long-term, difficult treatment. Some ground rules for treatment that we have. And I think they are of interest because they are probably true for other forms of treatment as well. First, the crucial importance of protecting the frame of the treatment, to have a security of the treatment situation and permit within that to examine the whole problem. The highest priority is, of course, the safety of the therapist patients who, some of these patients may threaten us in a dangerous way. We have to feel safe in order to really treat a patient. If the therapist doesn't feel safe, he can't provide safety to the patient. The importance of common sense. Before we establish complicated hypotheses, what's going on, we use just ordinary common sense to point out what seems crazy in the patient's life situation, in the patient's behavior, in the reaction toward us. So psychotherapy begins where common sense ends. We are impatient in every session, trying to advance as much as we can, but then very patient in the long run. The same thing repeats themselves endlessly, and we have to work them through. But we struggle against concrete inactivity, or so that every session in this long-term treatment, we see patients, this treatment requires 2 sessions a week over many months. Usually treatment is at least 1.5 years, sometimes 3 years or more. Transference management is possible in cognitive behavioral therapies as well, in the sense that on the basis of our interaction, we have our group, we have cognitive behavior therapists as well as psychodynamic psychotherapists, compare what we're doing, and it seems to me that the analysis of what is going on between therapist and patient and its transfer to the patient's conflicts in external life is perfectly part of skill training, could be perfectly part of skill training and validation in DBT. So that level, close to what is carried out in mentalization-based therapy or in interpersonal therapy, I think can be included and enrich cognitive behavior therapies. The tolerance of transference analysis is variable. There are patients who, with all effort and subtlety and experience, cannot tolerate that we examine what's going on between us and them. And so there are limits to transference-focused psychotherapy. And this brings me to my last point. When do we indicate cognitive behavior therapies? When do we indicate transference-focused psychotherapy? If the patient has concrete symptoms that can be circumscribed, that are serious and life-threatening, DBT is a treatment of choice. Suicidal attempts, parasuicidal behavior, certain forms of impulsivity, dissociative reaction, severe negative affect crisis. If, on the other hand, the patient's pathology of relationship has totally ruined the major areas of life, work and profession, love and sex, social life and family structure, then it's probably preferable to start out with a psychodynamic, then we would do a transference-focused psychotherapy. Mentalization-based therapy is really coincides with the early stages of transference-focused psychotherapy, is not in contradiction. So mentalization-based therapy is really included in what we are doing. So that's one kind of practical criteria, because we don't have empirical research that really compares cognitive cognitive behavioral and psychodynamic treatment in the sense that we know that with all kind of treatments, 30 to 50% of patients don't improve. That goes for all cognitive behavior therapies, for all psychodynamic psychotherapy. There's a percentage of patients who don't improve with one and might improve with the other. So another aspect of empirical approach is if you start with one type, well done, and it doesn't work, consider the possibility of alternative one. Patient who has been in very good psychodynamic psychotherapy, top experts, hasn't functioned, consider cognitive behavior one, and vice versa. Patient in 2 or 3 cognitive behavior therapies haven't worked, consider the possibility of a psychodynamic one. And I think that transference analysis is slow, lengthy, but gives a power for changing the personality rather than operating of symptom, which is, I think, is perhaps the most interesting finding of psychoanalytic psychotherapies. And you probably have seen that this contemporary concept of what is psychoanalytic object relations theory is quite different from what you may remember from traditional readings of psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis is a science in progress and unfortunately hasn't been spending enough time for empirical research and for communicating effectively the new developments in what we're doing. Thank you for your attention.